Hey everybody, got a little bit of RC Power's Mig29 V4 Mig Mania going on here today. I've brought all three versions of my RC Power's Mig29 version 4 that I've built thus far. If you've followed my blog or YouTube at all, this is the original built stock. I have about 230 some flights on this now. You can see the nose and paint scheme are starting to show a little bit of wear and tear, but it still flies great, still a blast to fly. This was the second one I built and the first one that I significantly modified. I have been calling this the V4 M3 E3, but I think to make it simpler, I'm going to call this one the NAMCV1 from now on. Since this one over here, the newer one, is, I'm calling this the NAMCV2. So anyway, all that boring nomenclature out of the way. I hadn't flown in a few days because we've had some rainy weather, which gave me the time to finish building this little beauty right here. So this morning when I came out, before I maidened this, I've already flown 6 flights on this just to try it out. And flies awesome. Talk more about that shortly. I flew both of these, the stock and the NAMCV1, put a couple of batteries through those as well, just to get the old thumbs and brain warmed up, and just to give me a benchmark to sort of start comparing things. The bulk of the mods on this V2 are very similar to the V1. Here you can see, hopefully, if I don't put my big fat head in the way, you can see right here the difference in the KF airfoil, both on this, on the NAMCV1 and the V2. That's extended back 1/4 inch over stock. When you look at all three of them, you know, hopefully you can see quite a bit of difference between stock and the modified version with respect to the size and shape of the elevons, just to help keep the back end a lot sleeker, cuts down on what Stefan and I call elevon polar pitch effect, which I think I've described ad nauseum in other videos and posts. But basically it's, you know, you got too much, if you have too much surface area back here, we've been finding with different planes, sometimes when you get up in a turn in a crosswind, it tends to push the tail out and make it sort of fishtail, which, you know, I don't mind doing that if I want to do it on purpose, but I personally don't like that being a habit of my airplanes if I can help reduce that somehow. So anyway, I'm going to just move, play a little shell game here and move these around so I can compare the tails primarily. Big difference you can see in the rudders, much larger rudders here on the V2 compared to stock as well. This angle here is about 13 degrees and this is more like 3 degrees. I borrowed this idea from the FRC Foamy's SU-35 Mark II, which I've been flying quite a bit. I have well over 200 flights on that plane now as well, and I really really like this rudder style. What I was looking for primarily was a bit more rudder authority in high alpha, but unfortunately it's a bit breezy today, so I can't really evaluate it. It does give me better rudder authority. I'll just slide this one out, slide this one in. So you can see quite a bit of difference in rudder size, because this rudder extends all the way to the top, and this is a more of an inboard rudder. Now, so far, just in doing hammerhead or stall turns, you know, get the nose up, slow down, let the speed bleed off, kick the rudder over. I don't need as much stick to get this plane to do what I need it to do. So definitely more rudder authority, which makes sense. I think I've got, in total between the two rudders, I have almost 5 square inches of moving surface more on the V2 than I do on the V1. The other thing, and I hate to do this because I only have about 6 flights on this, and I have 130 some flights on this one, but I have noticed, and it's good actually that it's a bit windy, because if there's bad habits or good habits in a plane, I find that, you know, a little bit of wind is definitely going to make those come out to the forefront. Maybe because, if I'll just quickly measure this, the way that I designed this tail, it's only 1.25 inches wide at the top, and here it's almost 2 inches wide. What I ended up doing, I was doing a lot of scratching my head, because in high alpha this one is a bit challenging to get to turn right for many, many reasons, which I've written up in detail on my blog at or the blog that I share with Stefan, migzerus.blogspot.com. This seems to be, because this angle here and everything else is the same, but because I angled this back about 3 degrees, it allowed me to expand the top here. And again, I'm a bit hesitant to say with only 6 flights experience, but I'm finding already that it's a bit more stable in the turns. It's quieter, maybe because the surface area is a bit wider in depth or chord here at the top. 3/4 of an inch doesn't seem like much, but I've been finding, both Stefan and I've been finding, when you really start getting down into the nuts and bolts and testing these planes, that 3/4, even 1/4 of an inch, for example, on these KF airfoils, it does make a big difference. I don't know if you can see that easily, but let me try and overlap these wings a little bit. The other major difference that I'm trying out on the my new paint job is a different size, different shape aileron. This starts off basically at stock, goes that's about 4.25 inches there, and this is almost 5 inches. So what I did was I moved the hinge line back about 3/8 of an inch, and I extended this out by almost 1 inch. And what this ends up doing is that half of the span of this wing back here now is moving surface, but it's not as deep in the cord. So I don't know, it's too hard to tell if that contributes as well to what I'm sensing as a little bit more stability in the turns. Just a slight difference, a different alteration of how the airflow goes over the wing. I'm not really sure. Again, wing loading might be a bit of a factor. Oop, comes a breeze. Oh, please. I'm gonna be safe and put this guy on the ground here, because I've had these things blow off the table. Sorry about that. Okay. So where was I? Oh yeah. This has just a slightly lower wing loading. It's about 0.7 of an ounce, I think, or close to 20 grams, 18, 20 grams, not sure. Can't do the conversion in my head that quickly, but so that may also contribute to why I feel it's a bit more stable in the turns. Not sure. So it could be one of many factors, but I'm a bit hesitant to say, but I'm thinking that it is a bit more stable that way. It definitely is very, very sleek through the air. I took a little bit of extra time to sand it. I'd also like to show here, when Stefan built his, I hadn't thought about doing this before, you can see the canopy here is much narrower. What I did was these two little side pieces, just like Stefan had done, I sort of put those underneath and then put the top tab. So now frontal surface there is 1.75 inches. And there it's about 1.5 inches. So, and then again, I did the same thing at the back. So it ends up being more of kind of an egg shaped, but hopefully it's a little sleeker. You probably able to hear it when I fly it here. I think this motor I put in this thing is probably past its due date. It's sounding a little rough. I swapped the prop out already, but it still seems to be running a little rough. And today's not a really good day to do any sort of speed trials. But anyway, the other thing I wanted to show you, this plane again. I think I mentioned in my build log on the blog that because the C of G's on, let's pick this bad boy up here as well. Because the C of G's on these all of these planes have ended up being significantly ahead of stock. So here's on this plane, there's a stock C of G, there's where I'm basically flying it. So that's almost 3/4 inch. On this one, again, probably about 3/4 inch. This one, not quite so bad. It's about 1/2 inch. So where the end of the ruler is there now, 1/2 inch ahead of stock. But anyway, you can probably see a trend there. So if you build one, don't be surprised. I mean, I know these are altered in the back end. So, you know, that changes around maybe the center of lift, center of gravity a little bit there. But don't be surprised. I mean, this is stock, like I said, and I've got my C of G 3/4 inch ahead of what the stock is per the plans. So if you build one, especially with KF4 airfoils, don't be surprised if your C of G ends up forward. So I'll just show you, these are where my batteries are all located for when I fly these. So I was able to get this. So that one's fairly far forward. I don't think I could fly that with a 1600. Where's the battery? Yeah, there's the battery right there. I've only got about maybe 3/4 inch. It'd be really touch and go whether I could still fly that properly with a 1600 without significant trim. Yeah, big difference here, right? Like there's maybe less than 1/2 inch. Had to throw in my little A there. Let's keep my Canadian friends happy. So here I'm actually, I'm gonna estimate, I've actually got, I wanna say almost an inch, yeah, 1¾ inches space, because I moved the servos quite a bit further forward, as you can see here, quite a bit further forward on this plane. Going into the build, knowing that. So anyway, that seems to work out well. So on a calmer day, and hopefully with a better, slightly better motor, I'm hoping to get this little beauty up around 90 miles an hour with the motor. Okay, just enough of my jibber jabbering here. So I'm just going to pause, put these other airplanes on the ground and get myself ready, and then we'll have a little bit of flight video. So I'll be right back with. All right, so just before we launch it, I just wanted to show you my my throws here. There's just the elevator, so I don't know, that might, I thought it was about 2 inches. It looks like it might be more than that. But that's plenty for what I need right now. There's not a whole lot of aileron, maybe 5/8 inch travel. What I've been finding, and I've said it many, many times, with these smaller aileron surfaces, they seem to work very efficiently, very little drag and turbulence, don't have any problems even down slow speed. You know, I'm down 35-40% throttle, no problems at all. And there's, you can see, a huge amount of rudder authority. And here's what I have for spoilerons, again, about 5/8 inch. Not a whole lot, but not a whole lot required. Although, you know, I've yet to evaluate how this plane handles high alpha yet. I have to wait for a calmer day than it is today. So anyway, here we go. Let's have a little fun flying right here. Okay. Okay, we'll just let this breeze, this gust pass through here. Into our early fall, unpredictable weather right now here on the west coast of Canada, so. So a little bit of bouncing in the wind there, but overall it's very. Very, very maneuverable, very nimble. The Mig29 V4, in any variant that I've built it thus far, it's exceptionally maneuverable. Ooh. I apologize for the sun, the time of day it is right now. So I'm gonna try and. So nice, smooth loop. You know, lots of authority still in these Elevons, even though they are smaller. You know, there's less drag, less turbulence. That was that loop that I did earlier was about half throttle, half deflection. So let me set up here and try a roll. So that was about half deflection. Let me try that again, a little closer. Whoop. Wind is tricky flying today. So no problems at all there. Lots of authority in the roll, at least for the way that I like to fly. You know, that's yeah, it's not the smoothest running motor that I have, so maybe it's time to sacrifice itself for parts, but she still got quite a bit of giddy up. So that was a slow roll there, about 40% throttle. Still very responsive in the roll. Oop. Tricky thing about getting slow in the wind. Bad things happen quickly. Ooh. That was kind of a dumb move flying into the sun. So I'm gonna try and pull up into a stall turn here and oops. Got a little slow, a little too much pitch there, pilot error. Yeah. Okay, let's do it on the other side here. I don't want to pull it up into the sun. So speed bleeds off, kick the rudder over. You see the nose comes right around. No roll. Like I didn't have to put any opposite aileron on there. Whoa, easy trigger. That was almost a rebuilding phase there. So I can tell just by the sound of how the air flows over the plane that it's much quieter than stock. You know, when you start to reduce turbulence, drag and turbulence, it makes the plane just that much quieter, I think, you know? Quieter from not just from this the sound level, but quieter in how it handles. Sorry, I'm not doing a lot of aerobatics here. It's just tricky keeping it flying in the wind. So let's try another, oop. So another stall turn there to the right. So excellent rudder authority. I'm maybe giving that about a quarter to a third. Oh, that was a half, so I snapped her over there pretty quick that time. She's not liking this wind too much, or maybe the pilot's not. Okay. Oh, not the smoothest landing into the wind, but we'll take it. Okay, so not the best flying in the world there in this wind, but anyway, it's proof of concept that it actually flies, which is always a good thing. So there's the RC Powers Mig29 version 4 NAMCV2 with some slight changes in the aileron and the rudder, primarily over version 1, as well as all the significant modifications from stock. So again, very impressed with how smooth and stable this flies. Get a little calmer day and be able to really assess how it handles with a bit more speed, with a little bit lighter, but very, very happy with how this worked out. Like I said, might be a little early to make the decision, but I think it is a tiny bit more stable in the turns because of the slightly different shaped vertical stab. Awesome rudder authority. Everything else is pretty much the same as the V1, except for one or two build techniques. But anyway, looking forward to getting some 1600 battery in there on a calmer day and really ripping her up. See what kind of speed we can get out of it. Probably tough to see on the video, but this paint scheme works out really well. Actually, on a bright clear day like this, it's not not that great. But winter's coming up here, fall winter. And we tend to have a lot more grayer skies. And I found with my a version of the FRC Foamy's SU-35 Mark II that I did in this sort of paint scheme, that it showed up really great, contrasted against cloudy skies. So anyway, we'll see how it goes as fall and winter approach. So there we go, folks. Thanks very much for watching. Take care.